And then you say, well, what was before the Big Bang?
Yeah, that's a good question.
And then if you find something else, if the astronomers go back a bit further using great techniques, and they find something else gave rise to the Big Bang, and then you go, well, what gave rise to that gave rise to the Big Bang? These are really unanswerable questions by either of you, aren't they?
But however you terminate that infinite regress, the one thing that's not going to work is terminating it by some sort of highly complex intelligence. You're going to terminate it by something simple. The Big Bang is a very, very simple event. Physicists don't quite understand it yet, but it certainly won't be a conscious intelligence designing the thing, because that requires a gigantic amount of explanation in its own right. You've explained nothing at all if you do that.
Well, let's get from Jared. You say you were an atheist for how many years?
About 13 years.
13 years.
Yes.
So how did you get back to being a theist from being an atheist?
Well, I read the same sort of books that Richard did. I was very much influenced by Bertrand Russell's Why I'm Not a Christian. It was a seminal work in my own life and so on. But it was largely this question. In other words, I'm a particular believer of a certain kind and so on. And that's a very, people can go in all sorts of different ways. As I looked at it, right, and as this is probably not a question that keeps a lot of people awake at night, but for me, it was a fundamental question. It's a question asked by Plato. It's a question asked by the Greeks. It's a question asked by the Chinese and so on. It's not peculiar. And some come up with the notion of the Tao. Heraclitus came up with the notion of the Logos and so on. And this is pre-religious and so on.
You're suggesting though that all religions are as valuable as each other.
No, I'm not suggesting that. I'm suggesting it's a fundamental question. They all fix on a principle which is self-explanatory, they will then begin to explain it in different ways, and they will have different consequences. Right? And that's a different question, and different sorts of evidence come in there. And again, I'm sympathetic to a lot of what Richard says about how you would deal with that there, and there's room for
that. Gentlemen in the audience, what do you want to say?
No, I find Richard a little bit condescending, which is sad, really, because me and Richard go back an awful long time. When I was in college, I was a biochemistry student. It was before I had so many grey hairs and in my flowing locks, and I lived with a bunch of lads who were doing was a physicist, a mathematician, and a whole range of people who were very excited by science. And we'd often have, there'd be many a night when we would have a discussion about Richard's books and about, we went about the developments in genetics and what it was to be human and all those kind of questions, because they excited us.
Okay, but what's your point?
We were also, as it happened, all of us, we weren't all Catholics, we were all people to whom our faith was really, really important. And it was part of our everyday existence. We lived and breathed it in the same way, and it excited us in the same way as science does. And in my case...
Can I just ask you to clarify? In one case, there is a logic within science. You may get to a point that you don't understand, but there is a logic, a framework. With religion, there is that the leap of faith which is required, because there is no proof, isn't that so?
You see, Richard constantly pairs this down to this, that faith is a simple matter of believing something for which there is no proof. But in my life, and I suspect in the lives of loads of people who are watching here tonight, faith is not that simple thing. Faith is a thing which is involved in your relationship with your partner, your wife, your husband, your children, with sad things, with happy things. And it doesn't come down to being proven or not proven. Richard reminds me of a painter who uses oil paintings, and is a master oil painter, and he despises anybody who uses watercolors or who uses pastels.
All right, Richard.
Richard, one palette.
Okay,
Richard. Let me answer that, because Jared made the same point. When you have a friendship with somebody loves you, and you know they love you, and you say, well, you're saying, and Jared is saying, that that's a matter of faith. Well, you know it's not. Because you're getting evidence, it's subtle evidence, but little catches in the voice, little looks in the eyes, little expressions, little everyday kindnesses, these all are evidence, they're tangible evidence, they come in through the sense organs. God isn't like that.
I'm afraid he is. For many of us, well, God is like that. And the thing is, you are always looking for evidence. You always talk about evidence, but you're not interested in evidence that doesn't meet your rule. Your rule is, if I can measure it scientifically, then it counts as evidence.
I can't measure scientifically if somebody loves me. That's
but how
not
do you
point.
Know,
it's
Richard?
Still evidence.
You have to
it's
take
still
it.
Evidence.
Yeah, but you
okay.
have to
I
take
want to hear
it.
Some more
you
voices.
Have to take it on faith.
Anyone else want to get in there? Yes, there's a woman there in white. Yeah, what do you want to say?
Yeah, I belong to the Humanist Association.
So you're an
Ireland.
Atheist, are you?
I'm an atheist for about 35 years, having escaped, as I saw it, from... I realised, actually, what I believed in was a religion. I used to talk to the sky and think it was God. and I was brought up a Catholic, and I believed what I was told. And then when I got to an age where I could start to think for myself, I didn't believe in the religion. And so because I didn't believe in the religion, I realized there wasn't a God to believe in. And I have never wanted to stop other people believing what they want, but I think there are so many of us who actually want to come out and say, we don't believe that, and we don't want you to pressure us to believing that. We are not doom-laden, gloomy people. We are very happy to live a very good life on earth.
You're saying you don't need God to make you good. No. Someone else. Yes, gentleman there.
Yes, I'm a scientist and a Christian, and evidence is very important to me in both realms, and I really believe that there is evidence to support the existence of God. But I was really disturbed by a number of examples in the book where you were very dismissive of evidence. For example, I'm involved in healthcare, and evidence-based healthcare is very important, and you say that there's very little evidence that religion is of any benefit in people's health and stress reduction.
Now, wait a minute. If religion is of benefit to people's health, that may well be true, and I don't deny that. But if it is true, that has not the slightest bearing on whether religion itself is true. It just means it makes you feel good.
Now, I agree with you, but you dismiss evidence which, according to the Oxford University Press Handbook of Religion and Science, the evidence is clearly positive in favor of...
What is the evidence, but just to clarify, what is the evidence that you have that God is there?
Well, this would be one piece...
As a scientist?
As a scientist, I look at the design that you see in the universe, at the amazing physical
constants... The complexity of the world.
The complexity, the physical constants... The fact that we have a moral nature in us, where does that come out
right.
of?
The moral nature, Jared.
Can I come back to this, because this relates to something Richard said? First of all, I agree with his last point, by the way, whether or not religion is consoling or in fact that you has absolutely nothing to do with this truth or falsity. It's irrelevant. It's nice. It's pleasant. It's a good by it's a by effect, as it were, but it's irrelevant to his truth or falsity. But the thing about the human relations is the following. If you take Richard's position consistently, and in other writings he's expressed himself in the following way, he said in relation to, say, for example, child murderers, that there's something that they're simply faulty, that it's pointless to blame them. Now, there's a problem with this in that position self-destructs. If people are not, as it were, responsible for what they're doing, in other words, then praise and blame have no purchase. They have no meaning. But if that's the case, you begin to
that's
evacuate...
That's biological determinism.
No, but it's not only that, but you evacuate human relations of all meaning and substance. In other words, the notion of love and affection and disinterest in love, and especially the love we have for our children, for example, becomes simply a pious fiction. It becomes a means
by which
our genes...
Let's talk to Richard about that. The whole thing, if you're biologically predetermined to behave in a particular way, well...
No, let's not get into that. I mean, I just don't even think that's interesting. I once flew a kite that maybe it was the wrong thing to blame people for doing terrible things. I don't want to defend that. That was just a thing I dashed off in two minutes, and it's nothing to do with my views on religion. It has no connection with religion. I mean, if your religion happens to be Calvinist, then you believe everything's determined, including whether you go to hell or not.
Quick clarification
before you're
from
even born.
Is it possible not to believe in God and be good?
Yes.
And to have no truck with God and be good.
Yes.
All right. Okay. yes, sir.
Richard, I'm interested in how this works in practice in everyday life. And I know that you have a daughter because you've written a letter to her in one of your books. And I wonder how you would see it if you believe that religion is a virus, belief in God is a kind of a virus that you call a meme. And so someone like you has been cured of that meme, that belief in God. You no longer believe in God. So if you were in a situation where your daughter had a child that was in some way born with some congenital defect and died very soon after birth, a Darwinian explanation of that would be that was a natural thing to happen. It's about the survival of the fittest. But how would that work for you in your life when you're speaking with your daughter in that terrible